Jolene Montgomery. I'm a professional barrel futurity horse trainer, and the barrel horse industry has completely exploded over the last several years. But just as a demonstration, if I'm gonna call one fancy broke, they're gonna have a great headset. They are gonna counter arc very well.
She's a blue jean baby with her hat down low, chasing that wild wind wherever it blows, flying through the night just as fast as she can go. Yeah, it's one right, two left, riding like hell round that cloverleaf pattern that you know so well. Sitting just right with the reins in her hands underneath the bright lights, chasing them cans. She's one of those nobody knows out making some noise. Yeah, she's a dark horse.
Okay, so I wanted to give everyone a couple examples of good or correct confirmation, in my opinion. This is a 2-year-old stud colt by JL Dash to Heaven out of a Cash Not Credit Nancy Ann Smith mare. Just looking at the horse overall, he's fairly balanced, neck length, back, croup and loin, all about the same length. This horse has a nice long sloping hip. You want to see that length there, that's always a good thing. He's got a nice strong Gascon muscle here. You want to see good muscle definition right here. An overall great shape to his back leg. He stands up under himself very well. Everything's nice and clean. We have a pretty short pastern, so that should be really strong on this colt. And everything's very straight. From behind, this colt stands plenty square. He's got some width from here to here. Inside muscle, all great things. All right, this colt is nice and strong through his back and loin. He's got a great top line here. Not too long, not too short. Good shape with just a little bit of dip in his back, but not too much. Ties in really smooth. Everything flows really great there. Again, same as the hip. Nice, long, sloping shoulder. See the length from here to the point of his shoulder? That's another sign of plenty of speed. He's got a good length to his neck. Again, plenty of length here. Clean through the throat latch. This is something I really, really look for and I think can be overlooked sometime. If they've got length here in this throat latch, usually means that they can break at the pole really easy. Got some flexibility. And looking from the front's probably gonna be the most important thing you're gonna look at on these barrel horses. You gotta make sure everything's straight all the way down their leg, which is beautiful on him. From the side, on these front legs, very important. You need a straight line all the way down. You don't want it to dip in at the knee or float out. You don't want those pasterns too long. great foot under him, good angles. It's just really hard to pick this colt apart. Okay, so as we all know, not every horse is gonna have perfect conformation. There are some things we can live with, some we may not, you know, kind of depends on the person. If there is a conformational flaw, you need to be aware, take it into account. It doesn't mean that it's a bad horse, but their long-term career could be jeopardized a bit. Oh, we gotta fly. So looking at this mare overall, you know, still a pretty nice looking mare. One thing you would notice right away, if you wanna look at her from the front, her left front leg is not quite straight. This knee is bowing out a little bit. We don't wanna see that. This mare has a little age on her. But if you see this on a 2 or 3 year old, I'd be very, very wary. And as you can see, this knot right here, I'm assuming is probably some arthritis. She's a broodmare now, but, and we hope she doesn't pass this on to her colts. I don't think she will. You never know what causes these things, but like I said, if you're buying a young prospect, this is definitely something that you would try to steer away from. So this is the two-year-old colt we showed for the correct confirmation. So we wanted to show you him riding around a little bit to demonstrate why correct confirmation is so important, and the fact that it allows this horse to be so quick-footed because everything is balanced. The ease of motion for this horse is astounding, pretty much. It is a two-year-old. Again, he's probably had 3 months of riding, and right from the beginning, you could tell that he was a great mover. And that's the conformational correctness absolutely helps with all of that. I think a lot of people and trainers alike run into trouble because they have a horse that's conformationally limited, or, you know, they may have picked a horse that may be a four-year-old that's super heavy muscled, and it's harder for that horse, you know, to physically do the things you're asking it to do. So that's another reason we like the conformational correctness. Okay, so I purposely picked Ugly Duckling for this little demo. This is Bullseye. She's a four-year-old by Chicago's Cash out of Return of the Bully. That's important because Return of the Bully was a great mare. I won 7 Futurities on her. This mare is very well bred. But as you can see, she is not drop-dyed gorgeous by any stretch of the imagination. She's faded. She lives in my pasture. She likes it out there. She's pretty sensitive and high energy. So, you know, I let her stay outside and burn the energy. It doesn't matter. but also, as you can see, she is missing her left eye. She was born that way, birth defect, not genetic. I've actually raised a foal out of this mare, so not genetic again. The reason I wanted to show her to you is to show you how you can get a deal. Most of us are on a budget. Of course we want to ride a beautiful horse. I do, everyone does. But sometimes if everything else is great, or almost everything else is great, we can sacrifice looks for a great mare, great horse. Like I said, she is missing that eye. It really doesn't bother her much at all. She was born that way. You know, you treat it with a little caution, but, you know, you can get a horse for a deal if you're willing to put up with a few things. I don't know if I would recommend everyone buying a one-eyed horse, but on the end of buying a horse that's not gorgeous, no, standing here looking at her, she's not gorgeous. She's pretty in motion, and she'll be pretty in a wind picture. That's what's really important to me. Okay, so if we're looking at this horse conformationally, overall, you see a really pretty picture. She is balanced. She's got great slope to her hip and shoulder. She's straight. Everything looks good until, oh babe, until we get to her hock. And this is a past injury. This mare is actually still in the healing process, but if you go to purchase a horse and take it to a vet check, if you see an abnormality like this, we're thick all the way through here, and there's kind of a shelf here. This is not a conformational flaw. This is an injury. And a lot of times these old injuries will be healed. The horse will be sound. And it's probably not going to be an issue, but don't be afraid to ask for past records. Ask the owner, ask the vet you're with and past vets what happened here, how long it took to heal, what exactly the issue was, to to give you an idea of what to expect in the future. Like I said, a lot of times things like this will be completely healed, but you definitely do want to look into it. And this is where I would absolutely ask for the records and what all the horse has done, what happened, and so on and so forth.
Jake Yolding, Famous Bugs, out of SR, Lois Lane, by Lane's Leinster. Here's Jolene.
All right, this is a four-year-old that's a futurity horse this year. He's by Famous Bugs, out of a daughter of Lane's Leinster. This is a great example of a longer strided, smoother horse. Not as quick-footed as the one-eyed mare or the two-year-old stud colt, but very user-friendly, easy to get along with. He's smooth, he's not gonna hurt your back. He tries to go make the same run every time. Very enjoyable horse. Okay, so horses like this, I believe, are easier for most people to ride. Because they're longer strided, they're moving just as fast as the shorter strided, quicker horses. But it feels slower. So you feel like you have more time to think about it and a little more leeway. They usually stay smoother and flatter in the turn, and just everything just easy. You'll notice he does have a tie down on. I wouldn't be scared of a horse wearing a tie down. I think when a lot of buyers say they don't want a horse to go in tie down, it's not that they don't like the tie down itself. I think people assume when a horse is wearing a tie down that they're hard to handle and high-headed, and that's absolutely not necessarily the case. Louis Bug wears one to help him collect when he approaches the barrel in a run. Because he is longer strided, it takes a little bit more time for him to get collected at the barrel, and this just helps when he bumps the tie down with his nose a little bit. That helps the rest of his body to gather up. If you're not confident about coming into the barrels two-handed or even going across the pen two-handed, a horse smoother and easier going like this should definitely be right up your alley. You can just switch hands, come across, you can stay one-handed the whole run. They're gonna do their job. It's smooth, it's easy. He'll still give his face if you want. You can stay one-handed and the horse should be expected to do his job. For me as a trainer, I prefer the quicker footed, more higher energy horses. Partially it's personal preference, but for a trainer with limited time and energy, because we may be riding 12, 15 horses a day, the quicker footed, higher energy horses are easier to train because we don't expend as much energy ourselves. The quicker footed, higher energy, they're gritty. They usually take to the competition aspect of it quicker. Whereas this guy, this is a fantastic horse. He's smooth, he's easy, he's enjoyable. But it did take longer for him to realize that this is a speed event. If you have more experience and you're a great rider, I would go for the quicker horse. I think it's, if those quicker, higher energy horses, more sensitive style, if they make a mistake a lot of times because they're so sensitive and quick-footed, they can recover from it a lot easier. Chances are this kind of horse isn't gonna make very many mistakes, but if he does, it's a little harder for him to recover. 7-year-old open horse. This horse has won a lot. He is a great horse. Just for an example of, there can be conformational flaws and still be a great horse, but they will need to be addressed. just the main thing to point out here is this horse's left front foot does turn in a little bit here. There's more hoof to the inside than the outside of the center of his ankle. This is pretty mild, and this definitely does not have to be a deal breaker. Like I said, this horse has been very successful. He's required some maintenance and some corrective shoeing. He runs great. Like I said, if you see this at a pre-purchase, this definitely does not have to be a deal breaker. It's gonna be really hard to find a perfect horse without any issues at all. So when you're looking for a finished horse, first off, you need to know what division you're looking for. Are you looking for top 1D, 1D, 2D, 3D, 4D, and all the way down? Obviously, a ton of people want a 1D horse, and a top 1D horse can cost a fortune. Again, most of us are not fortunate enough to have that in the budget. There's a chance you'll either have to settle for a 1D, 2D horse that may win locally, but may not at, say, a pro rodeo or a huge open, or you can make some concessions on the rest of your list of things you want. Start at the bottom. Okay, so I can't afford a beautiful Palomino top 1D horse, so look at a sorrel. Knock it off. Come from the bottom up of your priority list, looks being the least important. And then, you know, there's how easy it is to ride. If you have some training experience, or, you know, you're just a very good jockey, you can likely ride a horse that's a little harder to ride, and it costs a little less because not everyone is looking at this horse. Then there's possible soundness issues, and you're probably not going to want to buy something with major issues, but say it needs maintenance pretty frequently, and I mean, you know, hock or stifle injections or feed injections or special shoeing. You know, those are some things to take into consideration. You're going to be able to afford a higher caliber horse but have to deal with some other issues. So some of these things, these little slight issues or vices or behavioral problems such as cribbing or kicking, or it's not behavioral, but you know, if the horse needs a lot of maintenance, it is the seller's responsibility to disclose that, especially on cribbing, because you know, that is a big deal. It's there, the horse does it, everyone wants to know that. And behavioral issues, if the horse kicks and kicks bad, the seller needs to disclose that. Somebody could get hurt, and nobody wants that. And most sellers are very aware, and they want their customers to be happy, so they're gonna let them know. And buyers, on your end, before you go to look at the horse, or before you even make the phone call, if you know you just can't handle a horse cribbing in your barn, drives you crazy, don't go look at it. Just, you know, make it clear in your head right away. And if you can handle it, then it's no big deal, then that's good. You're probably gonna get the horse for a better deal. So buyers, when you go to try a horse, keep in mind that it's someone else's property and their hard work that they've worked on. Please don't expect to be able to try the horse, to be able to cruise it through more than once at home, or for the seller to haul it more than one place for you to run in a jackpot or what it may be. Like I said, most of the time I am willing to haul it to a jackpot, but just one time. You know, and if you've ridden the horse at home, you've ridden it at a jackpot, you should know. You've done your research, you've asked questions, you've seen videos. It's a fit or it's not. And even on the seller's end, sometimes if a buyer's still not sure what they want or not sure it's working, sometimes the seller should tell the buyer, no, this horse is not for you. And they, as a seller, most of the time, we never do this to be rude or to discourage a buyer. It's for their own safety and happiness. Sellers, your final ad should be as descriptive as possible. It's your prerogative whether or not you want to include the price. Buyers, it's your responsibility to sift through these ads and read the entire ad, please. Watch the videos that are included. And decide whether or not you need to send a message and try to get even more information and set up to try that horse. On a top 1D horse, like the kind of horse with equistat earnings over 100,000, I don't allow potential buyers to run that horse in public. They can come ride it at my house, maybe ease it through the barrels, but with a record like that, I just don't think there's anything for the horse to prove. And if you're buying a horse like that, the rider is probably a top 1D rider and shouldn't have any trouble running that kind of horse. Just keep in mind, you know, that they're animals and they have their own personalities. They have their own feelings, and chances are they've been with the same person on the same place for years. And when you take them home, it's just a huge change for them. They're social animals. And I know you'll do your very best to make them comfortable, make you happy. Just give it a little time. Don't try to rush things, and most likely you'll end up being successful if you've done your homework and bought the horse you wanted. But don't be afraid to give it a little time. You gotta put a little homework in, figure the horse out. He has to figure you out and get comfortable with you, and then you can go win. But to sum it all up, be honest. Know what you're looking for, get your priorities right, and know your facts, and you should be able to find your perfect horse, or close to perfect, and we'll see you at the next race.